Our series. UBBCP is an association of librarians, readers, and members of book clubs who want to spread our love of reading. I am Lorena Amos Brock. Let me introduce you to the rest of United Black Book Clubs of Pittsburgh's members. There's Cynthia Battle, Evelyn King, Lois McClendon, Benita Penn, and Helen Turner. We're also joined by Tom Poole from the Caribbean Book Club. Through a grant of Social Justice Rapid Response Fund from New Voices for Reproductive Justice Pittsburgh and our fiscal sponsor, Trying Together, this reading series is possible. We thank our partners, Pittsburgh Arts and Lectures, Carnegie Library of Pittsburgh, Homewood Branch, and Carnegie Library of Pittsburgh. We really appreciate the hard work of Pulse's Digital Media Company for providing the technical know-how to put this program together. Here we are presenting Celebration of Reading virtually. The 2020 theme is literary healing. What does it mean to be free? We're saying, come, let literature heal you. I know that a lot of people are tired of being in the house, tired of wearing the mask, and tired of not knowing where this virus is coming from. But if you use literature, you'll forget all about your worries. And today we have a special thing. We have a warmly popular author, Diane McKinney-Whetstone. We know you will have plenty of questions, and Benita will do the housekeeping and give you some directions.
Hi, everyone. Here's a few housekeeping tips for you. Everyone's microphones will be on mute during the author's presentation. After her presentation, there will be a discussion with the UBBCP members and question and answers with our audience. And if you're watching through YouTube, you do have to sign on to YouTube to use their comment. And you click in their comments and you can write your questions and comments throughout the entire presentation. And we will keep track of those, and we will pass on your questions to the author, and she will answer them. So enjoy.
Okay, so Diane, welcome. You know, I'm trying not to be like Oprah. You know how Oprah just gushes over people?
Gush, right?
And it's so interesting that I read Lazaretta. I read actually Leaving Cecil Street first. And I have Tumbling, but I ended up reading that again too. So I read Lazaretta for our book club. And I said, I really like this. So let me see what else she has. And then I wanted to talk to you, you know, just wanted to talk. I said, oh, wow, we got to talk about these characters. And then when we said we were going to do the reading series, I just took a chance. I said, well, let me ask her if she'd like to be in our with our reading series. And when you emailed me back, I said, oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. So everybody, this is Diane McKinney-Whetstone, and she is an award-winning author of five books, right?
Six.
Okay. And she has won many, many awards. She is from Philadelphia and went to the University of Pennsylvania. She says that later in life, she decided to be a writer. I happened to see this Facebook page and someone said it was your birthday. And someone said, and so you used to work for the Forest Service, is that right? And someone said, we miss you at the Forest Service. And I thought, who wants to go back to the Forest Service after being this world famous writer? So, Tom.
Yeah, I'm here. Okay. I'm that gentleman. I guess I'm the only male voice. So I'm that male voice behind the black screen.
So Diane, can you just give us a little background about the writing? Some people didn't read what I wrote, what I read, you know, about your writing and what spurred you on to write. And, you know, how you feel about some of your books. I have read all of them. I should have known six, right? I read every last one of them. So, you know, and talk about a little about your books.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Lorena, first of all, thanks so much for inviting me to participate in United Black Book Clubs of Pittsburgh summer reading series. Mm. I have been writing now, it's hard to believe, but my first novel was published, Tumbling was published in 1996. Mm. And as you noted, I was working for the Forest Service and I was approaching a significant birthday. And I won't say which one, but it was a significant one. And it's the kind of thing where you look over your life, where you've been, where you're going, and really asking myself, what are the things that I will regret having never tried. And I knew that I always wanted to write fiction. And even though in every job I've had, heavy on writing, I was actively engaged in writing, but not the kind of writing I wanted to do. And I had it in my head, this is what I want to do, but I wasn't doing it. And I just found it building up inside of me, and I can only describe it as this kind of internal thunder. That was nudging me on. And then I remember running into someone who I'd worked with years ago, and she said, Diane, are you writing? And I said, well, you know, I write all the time for work. And she said, no, are you really writing? And she said, do you know that if there is something inside of you that you must do and you don't do it and you ignore it, do you know that that energy will turn negative? Do you know that that can make you ill? And I was like, oh my goodness. I mean, I hadn't considered that it was that emphatic. I still didn't start writing. I was actually on a work trip and having to give a presentation in the after lunchtime slot, which is the worst slot. And true to form, during lunchtime, I was up in my hotel room working on my presentation. And I had the TV on as background noise. And there was an artist being previewed whose work was at this prestigious DC gallery. And they asked her, young black artist, and they asked her how had she started painting. And she said she'd never had any training in painting, but she was sitting on her couch and she was unemployed and her children were running around the couch. And she put her hands in her head and said, Lord, what am I doing with my life? And she said, a voice came into her head and said, why aren't you painting? And she said, painting? And she spoke of it in very religious terms of, you know, being led to go and get the paint and what kind of canvas to purchase and how to mix colors and all of that. And I was in awe as I listened to her and realized that I had been ignoring that voice for some time that said, why aren't you writing? So it was shortly after that that I started really by my excuse had been, look, I work full time, I have a family, you know, I'm otherwise engaged in all kinds of activities and I just don't have time. And writing fiction felt like a very frivolous thing. So I started getting up very early in the morning, like 4:30, 5 o'clock. That's the only time of day that I owned that I didn't have to negotiate with anybody else, with anything else. It was quiet, the air just felt pure. And I started writing, not knowing what I was writing about, where I was going, if it was a story, if it was not a story. And this world started falling onto the page that became the novel Tumbling. I was amazed. And it got to the point where I would look up and it was 8:30, you know, and I was the family's alarm clock and my children were late for school and my husband was late for work because I just got so swept up and so carried away. And that really is how I started. It was finally giving into this like internal thunder of do this, this is what you must do, this is what you must do.
Well, you sound like Toni Morrison because she said the same thing, that she got up so early.
Right.
Well, her boys got up so that she could write. And the thing is that you are a storyteller. So you know, before we came on, you were talking about your grandmother. And so you have to be a good listener, right?
I think absolutely. And I always love listening to stories. I love listening to my grandmother's stories, as I told you about, you know, the thunder. And my dad was also a masterful storyteller. And I just, as a child, just love listening to them talk. I can remember sitting and putting my head on my mother's arm as she talked and just like feeling like kind of her voice vibrate through her. I just, I'm captivated by stories. Even now, I just love to hear people tell stories and I'll ask questions just to get people to talk so that I can just hear about, you know, the stories of their lives. I'm just always fascinated by that.
And the thing is that why you're so important is that you have brought out themes about the Black community. You know what I mean? Like we always have had somebody come into our family that wasn't related. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. So there you go with that. We've had to deal as time went on with foster care, right? Uh-huh. We don't talk about it, but mental illness, uh-huh. You know? And especially with women, uh-huh. You know? What was, oh my goodness, and Lazaretta. So how did you come up with doing some historical fiction? But here's my question about Philly. That's the other thing, is that it's almost like you knew all about Philly, you know, like South Street, and then North Philly, because wasn't Johnson from North Philly?
Well, he was from West Philly, actually.
Oh, he was from West Philly. I thought it was because he was from the lower, you know, the part that wasn't that good, mm-hmm. that he was from North Philly, because mm-hmm. North Philly had a reputation.
Yeah, you know about Philly, I see. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, right. You know, so I'm saying it, you are telling us about Philly. It's almost like Philly is a character all its own, right?
Absolutely. The city actually does become a character in all of my work.
Yes, and it does.
I think it's because I need to start, since I often don't know where the story is headed, I need to start with what I do know, mm-hmm. and I do know the sense of place. Mm-hmm. And then the story unfolds as the readers, it's almost a symbiotic relationship between yeah. readers and the sense of place, and they feed off of one another, so that the place becomes as important. And to me, it is that I describe them as intimately as I describe the characters.
Yeah.
And Lazaretto, in fact, is a real place that exists.
Yeah, I looked it up. Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. And I mean, I was just fascinated by it that everyone knows about Ellis Island, but nobody knew really about Lazaretto. And right. It served a similar function. And then all the ships coming into the city during high quarantine season had to stop first at the Lazaretto so that the people could be checked to make sure that they didn't have fever. Sound a little familiar about today. And if they did, they were taken off of the boat and held at the Lazaretto at the hospital where they either recovered or, you know, in some cases died. So there was also a cemetery on the ground. So that in fact, that place just was so very compelling to me. And that's where I decided I had not really intended to write historical fiction, but as I did, I was forced to use my imagination and then put my imagination against the historical facts and reconcile the two. So
right, but the other thing about Lazaretta too is that what year did you write that?
I wrote Lazaretto. It was published in 2016.
And isn't that something? 2020.
Yes,
that's what we're going through.
What we are going through now, absolutely.
Right.
And even as I did the research, I mean, I realized that the ships that were much more like coming from Germany and more high class, the high class ships were often given a much easier pass.
Mm-hmm.
The boats coming from the Caribbean or other places were often held mm-hmm. for days and weeks. And so sounds very similar to today.
Yeah, because, you know, in Lazaretta, you also bring up that class distinction in the first place.
Right.
But you also bring up the fact that we might have that class distinction among the Black community, but somehow or another, our paths are always crossing,
crossing, right? And as it seems as important as the class distinction is, when we look at this, the larger issue of racism and anti-Blackness, then the class distinction becomes suddenly not important, and we're all Black people.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Right. Tom, where are you? Is he gone completely? Oh, he's my co-host.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, he said he was having problems with his camera.
Wow.
So the other thing is, let's see. So of course, so tell me, what is your favorite? What's your favorite book? You have a favorite?
No, it's like saying, who's your favorite child,
right?
Right, it's like, I have twins. So they're both my favorite. My son, you know, because he's my favorite son. My daughter, because she's my favorite daughter. So it is impossible to say. I will say that Tumbling, since it was my first novel,
uh-huh.
and just the way that the story kind of spilled on the page, Tumbling is very special to me. And then Tempest Rising, because it was very difficult to write. With Tumbling, I was just writing and it was like magic. With Tempest Rising, I had a contract, I had a deadline, I had an advance that I'd already spent. And so it was, I felt pressure. So I was, felt especially gratified to complete Tempest Rising and turn in a book that I was ultimately satisfied with.
Right.
Blues Dancing is just, I mean, I like that just because the places that it took me and you know, all of the novels teach me just a lot about human nature and really about myself. I mean, writing really is an act of discovery. And when I started Blues Dancing and realized that it was this story about these two star-crossed lovers who meet years after undergraduate school, and you know, Johnson had been through a heroin addiction, even though he recovered and was able to have ultimately a successful life. And I started writing the book and it was not coming together. And I realized that I actually knew people who did fall into heroin addiction when I was an undergraduate.
Female.
Male, and it was very painful to watch.
Yeah.
And so I wrote the book from this stance of how could they mm-hmm. do that from this very judgmental stance. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And the book was not coming together. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I kind of relived my own experiences. And mm-hmm. at the end of it, it was not a question of how could they, but, you know, well, for the grace of God, could have been wow. me. And once I had that, you know, sense of illumination, I was able to then write the characters with a sense of compassion. Yeah. It's very important for me that I have compassion for the characters, no matter what they're going through, even the worst, the ones who do the worst things.
Yeah.
I just want to have some empathy and really understand the characters. And I was able to then write the book from this not judgmental stance, but from a stance of empathy. And then the characters just came together and the book just took off. And it ultimately, I appreciate that book too, just because it really took me through some places, the actual experience of writing that book.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, talking about compassion, I won't mention names because these are well-known, very famous authors, right? And female. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times what happens with female authors, they have an axe to grind against men, right? Mm-hmm. And what I want to say about you as an author is that in all of your characters, male characters, that compassion is there. Mm-hmm. I mean, I love Johnson. Mm-hmm. You know, I was just as upset with him being a drug addict. He belonged to me, right? Mm-hmm. And Herb. Now, come on now, just because you can't get it right with your wife and you should have taken some lessons, you know, to sort of get her together.
Mm-hmm.
But he is with another woman, right? But I had compassion for him too. Right. And Lazaretta, oh, did I like him. I just liked him so much. Well, I liked the uncle too.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just saying that you do something that a lot of female authors aren't able to do. And that is to bring even those who are villains and who do bad things, wrong things,
mm-hmm.
you know, you make them real, you make them human, you make them so that we understand why they made those decisions. You know, like Johnson, I mean, what else, where was he gonna go? You mm-hmm. know, mm-hmm. pretty soon,
mm-hmm.
all that depression was gonna go somewhere, you know?
Sure, sure. Yeah, you know, that's interesting that you say that, because when I was working on Tumbling, and Terry McMillan was enjoying tremendous success, and she was taking, you know, like this incoming
criticism. Yeah, right. That's, I said, I'm not mentioning names.
About characters. And I set out with Tumbling with this idea in my head that my characters were going to be good Black men. They were not going to mess around. They were going to be totally, you know, monogamous and all of that.
Oh, that was when you first started.
I wanted to stick to that. But then when I started writing about this jazz singer, Ethel, it was as if the characters were saying to me, if you put us on the same page, we are going to get together.
Yeah.
No, this is messing up the book. This can't happen. No.
Yeah.
But I had to let it. I mean, I had to let the characters. Had to let the characters tell the story.
Yeah.
And guide the plot.
Yeah.
Because they all character centered, and so I allowed that to happen. But it was also with the sense that, okay, Herbie, I have liked you as I'm writing about you, and so how can I still like you and allow you to do this? And
right.
that opens up a whole new dimension right. in the main character, because that's when she, in fact, needed healing, as your theme right. is.
Yeah.
She, in fact, needed healing.
Right.
And so it just, it opened the book up by allowing the characters to have their way, and then to, for me to understand them enough to understand why, and then to render them in a way that I could still allow them to have their dignity and that I could still respect yeah. them.
And that's the thing, is that that they had their dignity. You know what I mean? Like, they made wrong decisions. You know what I mean? But they still had this dignity. They still had their humanity. And the other thing too is that, you know, why did they like him in the first place? You see what I mean? All the time you put them down, but there was something about them that made you like them in the first place. So that's what happens to most of your male characters, is that they still had that little semblance of goodness that made you like them.
Absolutely. You
know, all along, yeah.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah.
There's always, I've heard Toni Morrison say that she starts on, you know, I've interviewed her a couple of times, and she says that she starts each novel with a question. Mm-hmm. And it's a question that she then just answers throughout the writing. Mm-hmm. And I think that I start each novel with a secret. But the thing is, I don't know what the secret is at the point when I'm starting. Right. But I know that there's something that I need to discover about these characters. And once I discover it, I then need to render it in a way that the reader will just follow along as this secret gets unraveled through the pages.
And you know that I don't have the whole title, but the one about the mother who it seemed like she had schizophrenia.
Mm-hmm. Trading Dreams at Midnight, yeah.
Yes, right. And that the effect that all that had on her daughter, well, both children really, but the daughter. Mm-hmm. And that's something that we don't really think about either. You know, we don't know how that mental illness of a parent resonates with the children.
Sure,
you know?
Sure, absolutely, absolutely.
I mean, you got that right there. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So is there anything you want to read to us?
You know, I can actually read the opening pages of Tumbling.
Okay. All
because
right.
It needs no other introduction other than to say that Tumbling is set in Philadelphia in the 1940s and 50s, and really was inspired by my mother's stories about her neighborhood and how she grew up. Mm-hmm. You know, this part of slice of South Philadelphia that she would talk about. Oh, it was safe. It was clean. It was, the music was incredible. And the church was central, and it was just so idyllic. And we'd like, well, if it was all that, why'd you move? I mean, because we were raised in West Philly. And she said, well, because they were going to build a road. Mm-hmm. And so that kind of inspired the story Tumbling. So I'll just read the first, how much time do I have to read? Like the first
few? Oh, 5 minutes, yeah.
Okay, great. The Black Pre-Dawn air was filled with movement. Its thin coolness rushed through the streets of South Philly, encircling the tight, sturdy row houses. In 1940s, the blocks were clean and close. The people who lived here scrubbed their steps every morning until the sand and the concrete sparkled like diamond pins. Then some went to work mopping floors and cooking meals for rich folks, or cleaning fish at the dock, or stitching fine leather shoes or pinch-pleated draperies at the factories on the north side. Some answered phones or crumpled paper for the government. Some tended house and nursed babies. A few were really nurses. One or two taught school, unless it was on the weekend. On the weekend, the blocks came to life. They'd cram into Club Royale, where redheaded olives danced in gold-colored liquid, and the music flowed like bubbly, and brown faces laughed for real. Not the manner tee-hees of the workday, but booming laughs. And Sunday, they shouted in church and felt the sweet release where grand hats rocked and high heels stomped or went clickety-clack, depending on how the spirit hit. Right now, they slept, especially if they'd been at Club Royale earlier. They were in a heavy sleep as the moving air wrapped around their chimneys and stroked their curtain windows and slid down their banisters. It breezed past the church where the bricks were gray and jutted into the dark air and even shone from the dew that was just beginning to settle. It shimmied over Pops, the corner house famous for its glass jars filled with sweet pickles pig feet, and then dipped past the funeral home owned by the Saunders, where the Model T hearse was usually parked out front. It blew over the playground, where a makeshift swing hanging with tufted braided clothesline swayed to the rhythm of the dancing air, and then turned on through a short block where Car Play and Rose lived. The light from her basement meant the kings and queens and aces were slapping her fold-up table, adorned with piles of red and green chips for quarters and dollars and IOUs. And then the night air moved all through Lumber Street and bounced up and down the long block where Noon and Herbie lived. Right now, it caressed a brown cardboard box being slipped onto Noon and Herbie's middle step. Noon was fast asleep this Sunday morning, still hours before her faithful church bells would give her the early riser's wake-up call, so she didn't hear quick swishes of leather against concrete rushing straight to her house. Nor did she stir when the rustling sound got louder as sweaty palms shifted the box gently along the steps so they wouldn't tip. But if Noon or anyone else on the whole of Lumber Street had been only half awake, she surely would have heard the singular whisper tinged with a sadness that was dark as the night. The air heard it and swallowed it up and whipped around the corner to push Herbie on home. Herbie was wide awake, walking through the streets as the air nudged him on, heading in after a night of clapping to the beat, then hanging later at Royale because he'd heard Ethel might be coming back, then stepping outside of Royale and running right into Bo, the barber who cut hair at the end of Herbie's block, and having to suffer through a lecture about the wages of sin and ignorance. Herbie appreciated the way the moving air was at his back. He needed a push to get home. The red and white candy cane lamp in front of Bo's barbershop made Herbie mad again as he thought about Bo's finger wagging in his face and his voice all in his ear saying, "Boy, you got a good wife. Stop trying to live the fast life chasing women and hanging in those clubs." He got some nerve, Herbie thought. He ought to be glad my sweet pretty mama taught me to respect my elders. I would have yanked his finger and told him to mind his own business. Herbie kicked at the air as he walked past Bo's. He didn't consider himself a woman chaser anyhow. There was his wife, Noon, and there was Ethel. At least there had been Ethel. He hadn't seen her in several months, but now the thought of her roundness filled his head, the way she moved like fire and made the air crackle when she laughed. The thought warmed him as he pushed up Lumber Street toward home. And I'll stop there.
And then the intricate part of the bar. I mean, it's part of the neighborhood, you know?
Yes, absolutely. The bar absolutely was part of the neighborhood. Yes, mm-hmm. For sure. Yes.
All right. So, United Black Book Clubs, you ready? Where is everybody? Oh, just Tyler, you got to unmute them.
So, I will say this. Miss Diane, although I'm not finished with blues dancing, I can't wait to finish it. The way you write is like my favorite song. It's some type of music that you just want to hear it again. So I find myself rereading a sentence or a paragraph because the way you so elegantly describe it, just as you did just now from reading something from Tumblr. How do you do that? I mean, that's just, it's not just writing words, but you put a whole, you describe things so elegantly that it's like a painting or a favorite song or something. You understand what I'm saying? I mean, I don't know how else to say it. That's just, to me, it's just so beautiful.
Thank you so much. I mean, I really appreciate that because I do work hard at writing. I mean, writing is hard work. It's a lot of work. And I do work hard. I'll start a sentence with a rhythm, a beat in my head. And then I'll work and work until I'm satisfied that, you know, the sentence is doing what I wanted to do. If it needs to be weighty or light or fast or slow or introduce new information, I mean, I'll work and work until I get it right. And I mean, it drives my husband crazy. It's like, just finish it already. Just type the end. But I do. And I need to satisfy myself. And I think that is what, that is both the torture and really the joy of writing. It is absolutely the torture and the joy.
Well, thank you. And I am looking forward to reading the rest of the book. So thank you so much.
I appreciate that.
This is Tom.
Hi, Tom.
Can people hear me?
Yeah.
Diane, it's great to meet you.
I can see you. You can't see me. But I am actually a first-time reader of your work. I was very impressed. So I do have a couple of questions. My first question is this. I'm a big fan of, as many in this group know, of movies and films, things like that. And I just saw this series on HBO. They did a new version of Perry Mason. I don't know if you've seen that.
It's on my list.
Or you've heard of it. Mm-hmm. And after I'd seen the whole series, the thing I thought about was that it was basically a 21st century story, but it was based in Great Depression 1930s. And I thought about your book, and I thought about that in many ways, Lazaretto specifically, because that's the book I read, is a 21st century story, but based after the Civil War. And I wanted you just, you know, kind of elaborate more about that. How do you get modern themes intertwined in a historical period?
Yeah.
So that's my question one.
Yeah, that's really a good question because historical fiction, I mean, it needs to be historically accurate. And it was really my first foray into something that quite that historical. I mean, with Tumbling, I could talk to people who were still alive during that period to evoke the neighborhood and what was where on what street corner. My father was really helpful in the early chapters. But with Lazaretto, it was like, it was hardcore research. So that there was that, it needed to have that, but still the things that the people were actually living through, the emotional content is what I would come back to again and again so that it could feel relevant even in today's times. I mean, because in that sense, there's nothing new under the sun. And so I kept coming back to, I mean, just, you know, the love between a man and a woman, that this, you know, the passing theme that has kind of been tiptoed in and out of literature. You know, I thought that when I was initially writing it, I thought in fact that, you know, this young woman was going to pass so that she could be with this, who she thought was a white man. And as it turned out, well, no, he passed. It's like, you know, why does she have to want to be white? Why can't he want to be black? And so I inverted it and that felt also very contemporary for me. So it is, I think the emotional part that I use, the emotional core of the characters that I use, so the material feels relevant, even in this day, in this time, though it was set just to, you know, it opens at the end of, you know, at the night that Lincoln is assassinated. And then just follows a few years beyond that. So the emotional core is what I use to stay so that it can be steeped in today and so that I can understand the characters and I'm understanding based on my own realization and my own understanding of human nature. So I think that's how it works for me. This just like dichotomy.
So this is my follow-up. And that is Lazaretto, it felt like a prescient book. I mean, just what's happening today.
Absolutely.
With yellow fever and absolutely, what's happening with COVID-19.
Absolutely.
So I just wanted you to also talk about those parallels. I mean, when you were writing the book, I'm going to assume, and you may tell me differently, that you weren't expecting us to be in this pandemic at the moment. But it's just so relevant right now. So yeah, could you talk about maybe some of the parallels now? You had some time to possibly reflect on that?
Absolutely. And the thing about yellow fever is that at the point when the novel opens, there is still the misconception that of how it spread. I mean, that, you know, they thought it was from dirty rags, that there was not really an understanding of the disease. It was just a horrible, horrible disease. Similar to COVID, it affected like every part of the body. And it was just, you know, the deaths were just ugly, ugly deaths. And so, but there was really a lack of understanding about the genesis of the illness. It was much later when they were just, the medical community was just beginning to catch on that it was in fact mosquitoes causing it. And it's like every day there is new information about COVID and what it does to the body and how it affects the body, how you catch it. You know, asymptomatic people can catch it. Initially it was, you know, you don't have to wear a mask unless you're a medical professional. Now you need to wear a mask, so that there is this learning gap. And just as with yellow fever, a lot of people died because there was not an understanding about how the disease was spread. The same happens now. And of course, there, you know, I wrote the book with no crystal ball into what, you know, this like horror show that we're living through now with this disease and the management of this disease, but that it actually does have parallels to that that pandemic as it was.
Yeah. Thank you for that.
I have a question.
Oh,
okay, Diane, I have a question. I've read all of your books and have enjoyed every one of them, but I want to focus on Leaving Cecil Street. Are any of the characters in that story people that you know or have known?
Not really. I mean, all of the characters start off, I suppose, as types of people that I know or have known. And then they just take off and morph into their own personhood, as it were. And so that even though they may start with this seed of a person I know or have known, by the time the novel is done, they will be entirely unrecognizable. The thing that I do know is the community. And I mean, Cecil Street is just familiar to me, so that I know Cecil Street. I mean, I spent a lot of, there was Cecil Street that actually intersected my block. And so just neighborhood where everybody knew each other, you know, where there were block parties, you know, people left their doors unlocked, the in and out. And then this tragedy happens with these two young girls. And that then just amplifies the story and amplifies the cohesion and changes everybody on the block. And secrets are revealed. And so that I don't necessarily know the people, but I do know the place. I mean, I just know like Cecil Street, Cecil Street intimately.
Well, it reminded me of a small street that I grew up on called LaPlay Street. Mm-hmm. And it was a sense of community in that area too. And we used to have block parties as well. Mm-hmm. So that was one thing. The other thing I wanted to focus on is abortion. Mm-hmm. Seems to play a central role, mm-hmm, in Leaving Cecil Street. Mm-hmm. Why did you focus on abortion?
Well, again, the story, the characters kind of like pull me along. They pull the story along. And as it turns out, this young girl gets pregnant. And she has like huge promise. And it was at this point in time, I mean, when I was coming up, maybe a few years before I was coming up, if a young woman got pregnant, you know, still in high school, like she might be sent down south and then suddenly come back and, you know, her mother is raising a cousin or something. It was just such a taboo thing to do. And or she got married. I mean, something happened along those lines. And then when I was coming up, it suddenly was not as taboo as a taboo, except that, you know, what it would do to this young woman's life. I mean, she was planning to go to college and here she finds herself pregnant in high school. Okay, and so now what? And she decides to terminate the pregnancy. And if, you know, if you've read the novel, you kind of know, you know, I was like in that scene, when I wrote that scene, I was like, in it. I mean, there are some scenes as I write that like everything comes together. My imagination, I mean, what I know, what I understand, what I didn't realize that I knew that I suddenly know when I'm in that scene. Everything came together in that scene for me. And it was visceral. And it was like one of those scenes that I just wrote and couldn't stop writing until it was done, because it just, it flowed in that way. And so that then became the change agent for that block, because you know, this was like the block's, you know, their brightest flowers. This was the hope of the block and the hope of the community. These two best friends who live next door to each other. So, so it then the whole issue of abortion became, it became an issue in the novel as well.
Thank you.
Sure. Diane, I want to ask you a question that's similar to what Cynthia was talking about. I want to compliment you in all of your stories. You seem to deal with all of our senses. There's the sense of smell, and it becomes alive, and our sense of touch, when, like in blues dancing, when they would just touch each other with their fingertips, like all of the senses come to life in your stories. Is that on purpose, or how do you make that happen?
As I am writing, I'm asking myself, you know, what would this feel like? How does the air smell at this moment? How does the air feel? I mean, is it hot? Is it cold? I mean, just like taking the temperature of the room, and what are the characters seeing? And particularly the sense of smell, because, you know, the sense of smell is carries with it such memory. And so I use that a lot. And just the, you know, the writing, just the story becomes much more sensual to me if I am just using all of the senses, and I just ask myself those questions that I'm writing. In fact, when I am stuck in a scene, I like have the character look around. What does the character see? I mean, what does the character feel at this moment? What's the character hearing? You know, what are the sounds running through the air? And then things will open up for me. And the scene will tend to take off. So that's important to me as I'm writing, to just create this whole world and everything that makes up the world.
That's certainly a gift, and you do it so well. Just like in Lazaretto, like the smell that came to them when they were walking up the path, which made me go further, and I saw that people in the South did that, and so I didn't know the reason why they would have like I forget which one of them it was now, but that's so like when the women move with their dresses, and then that smell would go. I just think that's the beauty in your writing.
Thank you.
Uh-huh. Yeah, this is Lois Toney. It was like, I only read Lazaretto, the first book, and I'm going to read all your books, but it was like I was reading, like I was watching a movie as I was reading. It was just so vivid and so full of emotion, and your use of language and languaging. I was just about every other page, I was writing down something that sounded really lyrical or poetic. Mm-hmm. And I just like the way that you use words and put together. When you were describing Sylvia at one point, Sylvia, mm-hmm. and Lazaretto, and you used all those S's in the second, mm-hmm. and you talked about the night sky. It was the most sensuous, full book that I have ever read. And it was like I could see people clearly in my head. I even could imagine what people were looked like and what they were doing and how they were really feeling, even down to their soul. And that's a really gift, because not very many people can capture the full scope of, I guess, humanity, which was clearly in that book. And the other thing I wanted to say was just about everybody I know had a picture of Lincoln on his wall, even down south. Whenever we had one on my grandmother's a wall, and people would say, well, one of my cousins said, well, Abraham Lincoln must be one of our cousins because he's on the wall with all his family. I just absolutely love the book.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
I have one question, and it's about the craft of your writing. Mm-hmm. in all of your books, Diane, you have a lot of characters. You just don't have like one or two main characters. It's like a whole community of characters that you have. And all these people have their separate backstories, their separate personalities. How do you create those? Do you have like a list that you have of like characters and you write down what they are, what they do before you put them in the book? Do they come to you as you're writing the book?
Mm-hmm. They come to me as I'm writing the book. And so I don't know much about them at the point I start. I mean, I start with a sense of what I think the book is about. And once I get into the writing, it quickly departs from that. But I don't know at like how many characters there'll be. It's just as I'm writing, a person will seem to appear. And the way that they shape up for me really determines how much time I spend on them. I mean, the characters that just seem flat, that don't want to move, that don't have many dimensions, that mm-hmm. don't have an especially exciting or complex interior world. Those are the characters that, even though I thought they may have been the main character, that just kind of fade into the background. The characters that do present with a complexity are the ones that are most exciting to me and that I will then spend time on. And sometimes I'll be midway through the book and realize, boy, there's a lot of people here. But that's just, they're there to help tell the story.
And I have one more comment. I read Tumbling, and I was so angry at her mother. Of course, I had to remember that back then, she was raped. And her mother really didn't have the resources to help her
right.
confront that or heal.
Right.
The entire book, even though I knew this in the back of my mind, right. just so angry when she would remember what her mother would tell her. It's just like, what did she do to you?
Yeah.
But I mean, it just shows, you know, what we lack and how it can hurt, how it can damage us.
Absolutely. As her mother said, don't tell. Don't ever tell if you cannot tell. Her mother drilled that into her. And so she kept this, she kept it inside of her. It was her healing when she was actually able to let go of it. But that was just her mother. And I think perhaps her mother's view was a common one in her mother's generation, that a girl didn't talk about those things. If such a thing happened, she didn't talk about it. So, yes.
Well, thank you so much.
Yeah, so in Tumbling was that role of the church. Mm-hmm. And how it came out that the minister didn't even know how to read.
Right.
And so, you know, it was almost stereotypical that she was, you know, sort of like a prune dried up, and that her love was for the church. Mm-hmm. But when it was all dispelled, then, that also mm-hmm. got her towards her healing.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Can I just interject real quickly? I know we are really short on time. I know that we have a YouTube audience, and if there's, I don't know who can retrieve any of those questions, if there are any, but I just want to make sure those folks get a chance to get a question in. And I also have a question from Otis King that emailed me. He wanted to ask you, most of your novels are set between the 1940s and 1970s. What is your affinity with those eras? And he would also like to know, what are your inspirations?
Oh, good questions. Those are the eras that when I'm writing just are compelling to me. And so those are the time periods that I want to explore. I will say that the novel that I am working on now is entirely contemporary. It's like set pretty much today, maybe a couple of years before today. It's set very much in contemporary times and is very different from historical fiction, but also challenging because if I'm writing of an era that you know, not currently living in it, I use my imagination and but writing a entirely contemporary novel means that it's almost like I can just look around and chronicle. And so I can like kind of lean on what I see and what's now as opposed to my imagination. I do find though with this novel though, that there are lapses into the past. And so it still is going back to those like 1970 era when the people were in college. And I suppose I have an affinity for those decades.
What are your influences?
You mean readers? I mean, other writers?
He left it pretty open.
Okay.
What are your influences?
Yeah, you know what? Sometimes I'll listen to music. I love the Coltrane piece that you all opened the show with. Music can certainly be inspiring and all kinds of music. I just love what Toni Morrison was able to do with the language. And so I will read her just for, you know, the possibilities. Like, oh boy, a human being can actually do this with the language. Mm-hmm. I'll certainly read her for that. I mean, I love contemporary writers, you know, like the snappy dialogue. I mean, I like Terry McMillan's, like the way she, like her dialogue just pops. That can be inspiring to help me make sure that the people that I'm writing about are talking the way that they actually talk. So those are all inspirations. You know, when I go to church, I mean, on Zoom now, but like that can be an inspiration just because it's soulful and so much of writing is just an act of faith. It's like stepping out, not knowing where you're going or where you'll end up, but stepping out and walking anyhow. So certainly, you know, my faith is also a huge inspiration for me.
I know that we don't have a lot of time left, so I would love for Lorena to take it home. Although I do have one more question, only because Kamala Harris was just nominated. And when I think of your characters, especially Sylvia, Mita, mm-hmm. even Nevada, and I love Nevada's grandmother. I can't remember her name, but I loved her, right? Mm-hmm. What would they be thinking today about Kamala Harris being a possible VP of the United States?
They would be doing this because, you know, the Black women in my novels really are the moral center of the novels. They are the core. They are the ones who make things happen, who allow things to happen, who are there to absorb what happens. And so, oh my goodness, they would just be applauding that this Black woman is now, you know, on this ticket, you know, with Biden and very well headed to the White House. I mean, they would just be applauding. And I mean, it's right. It is just, it's right. It's momentous. It's totally historical and all of that, but it is also very right. I mean, it's as it should be. And I think that, you know, those women that I spend so much time with in these fictional worlds would be just applauding like, yes. I mean, finally, this is the time. This is it. This is now. I mean, and what better person? I think that one of the advantage of this whole process went through even with the vice presidential pick was just the elevation of, and you can see, I mean, this list could have gone on and on. I mean, I'm glad that it's Ms. Harris, but the list could have gone on and on, just how deep is our bench of Black women who can do this. And the world can now see this, so. Absolutely. Yes.
Uh-huh. Take it away, Lorena.
All right. So, you know, and I've just one more little tiny thing too, is that I forgot about the role of the women in your novels because they do. I mean, you know, the thing that I always say about the role of the woman is that the woman does set the standards. And in every last one of them, Mita, I mean, golly, I wanted to be like Mita. You know what I mean? Just so gentle, so whatever. And all these things happening to her and powerless, but she still had this dignity, you know? Even Noon, mm-hmm. like, you know, she took in those girls and loved them. They didn't miss a beat, not one beat.
In Black women, we don't miss a beat.
Mm-hmm. That's right. That's right. Just took it up. So, you know, Maya Angelou said that easy writing is hard reading.
Oh my gosh.
And easy reading is hard writing.
Oh my goodness.
So I thought of that when you said, oh wow. I mean, you know that you took your time. I thank you. I thank you. I thank you. I thank you. And let's do this again, all right? Let's do this again.
Okay, thank you so much. I appreciate it. Okay.
And thank you for taking us on this literary healing journey, because it truly was healing.
Thanks so much.
Right, right. And that is our solution, is literary healing. What does it mean to be free? Well, we thank all our audience for tuning in. We are sorry for those people who were not able to get in. We're going to do this again. We'll see you again. And everybody, please be safe. Knowledge without wisdom is like water. Good night.
Good night. Thank you so much.
Good night. Yeah.
Wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed. No more back thinking, time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much from what it used to be. There's so much hatred, war and poverty.